Modernism was very glad to be in Los Angeles right now as an art maker, as an artist.
It's a great pleasure to be here, to be talking with Shaun Gladwell, who I've been a great admirer of his work since that extraordinary video of skateboard riding in stormy Bondi lit up conversations all across Sydney. There was a time there where every conversation he had, people were talking about Shaun Gladwell. So it's really exciting to be here and to be with the foremost Gladwell critic in the world. So a great pleasure to be here tonight. Thank you for the invitation, Erica. I thought I might start with talking about the backs of heads, a topic of great trauma for me. When I was a young girl, I got terribly ill and I lost all the hair on the back of my head. And for some time, I kind of tried to keep my head up against walls so nobody could see the back of my head. So please don't run and look at the back of my head when tonight's over. When you go upstairs, you immediately see the backs of heads and they're immediately traumatic. There's something so vulnerable about the backs of heads, whether you have hair or not. They're the most vulnerable parts of us. And I don't want to get too psychoanalytic, but of course Lacan, the French psychoanalyst Lacan, talks about how when we look in the mirror and we see our inverted image, it coordinates ourselves. We see ourselves as an organized other through that image in the mirror. And at the back of the head, there's no capacity of organizing who we are. There's no mask, there's no stage, we can't play ourselves. And I think those images upstairs where you have the back of the head and its background is a war zone, is just a really profound and provocative and somehow threatening image. So I thought we might begin by talking about the backs of heads.
That sounds good. Maybe we could turn around and face the wall. But before I speak, maybe I should say that it's intimidating being up here to some extent next to Kit, because he's an authority on my work and he's written a book on my work. And I kind of realised that at one point he actually knows more about my work than I do.
So if, I explained it to him.
Yeah, so if you actually see Kit interrupt me mid-sentence and say, "No, I think you're trying to say this," he's not being rude. He's just illuminating me on my own work. So, but I do like the way that we're talking about the backs of heads. It's a great subject, and something that I've been passionate about is thinking about how to represent without playing into sort of models of portraiture that have popped up again and again in history. So, portraiture's been such a complex field of representation. We all love it for a lot of psychoanalytic reasons, of course. It's like an affirmation of the self, and it's an incredibly complex engagement. But I thought, when I would look at portraits in history, I was always interested in a kind of a moment where I was aware of what I was doing looking at a portrait, like a double looking, when I was looking at someone looking. And that would often be when I was looking at the back of someone's head, looking. And of course, a really great example of that for me and for many other artists is the German Romantic painter Caspar David Friedrich. And he has this great painting from 1818 called Wanderer Above the Sea of Fog, which a lot of us will know here, of this suited dude up on top of this huge kind of alpine vista. And I also think that is also a very vulnerable position for us as a subject to be behind someone, because they are without peripheral vision behind them. And I was reading that in terms of biology, our eyes are not situated on the side of our skulls so that we do have better kind of panoptical vision. We're kind of predatorial and we've got the binocular vision forward facing, so that is the blind spot in a lot of ways, and that's kind of a metaphor as well. So yeah, I think The back of the head is something that I was interested in exploring with soldiers and people who were in a very kind of treacherous environment. And also, it became not treacherous for me, but obviously, you don't sneak up behind people that have got guns. It's not a good thing to do. So a lot of the times I did ask them if I could shoot the back of their heads. I didn't do that unannounced. So yeah, that's kind of one of the motivations, but there's probably a few readings of the portraits beyond my little anecdote.
Well, when I see Shaun's work, a lot of Shaun's work, and I'm sure this is a thing that will come up a lot tonight as well, a lot of Shaun's work is to do with doubling. You know, there is a lot of double screen works that you see throughout his work, throughout his entire body of work. There was an exhibition called Stereo Sequences that was at the Australian Centre for the Moving Image in 2011.
Yep.
And that almost was entirely these double images. With the images of the point of view portraits of the back of the soldiers' heads, you get this. As Shaun said, you can see what they're seeing. So you get to see this landscape, and it's interesting that he attaches it to Wander Above the Sea of Fog, because that is about this idea of the sublime landscape. You know, this idea that when you're confronted. Do people know that particular painting? It's this dude on top of a mountain who's looking over what would be actually quite a frightening scene in nature. It's this very vast scene. And what we're getting really is a kind of a surrogate for ourselves that is inserted into that image. And what we don't see is the response, is the affective response on that guy's face is on top of the mountain. We don't know whether he's smiling, he's face from ear to ear, or whether in fact he's, you know, looking terrified. But we do see what he sees, and I think the really interesting thing in those portraits is this, you know, this double looking, this being able to see, and this is a theme that is really throughout Shaun's work in Afghanistan, being able to see to some extent, or an attempt to see from the point of view of the military that you were working with at the time.
I guess another thing I was interested in is by denying people the face, which we all expect, I think, through standard portraiture, you have to look at other signs in the picture. Like, so certainly you have to look at what they're seeing, that field of vision that you assume they have in the photo. But also there were like differences in uniform. There were obviously different roles people were playing that you could kind of maybe, or that I was trying to like pick up through those like little cues. And so people would have, like, say, I mean, some of them quite obvious. Someone had AusAid written on their shirt, so that was a dead giveaway. You don't get many points for guessing that guy's role. But certainly there were more ambivalent, sort of ambiguous moments in that portrait series. And they were culled down from quite a few. There's one portrait of a guy who has this kind of windswept dark hair and he's wearing a headband, and he's not immediately identified as an ISAF military member, and so he has this kind of curious position within the photo series. And he was in fact a special forces guy, but who was also working, he was an Afghani National Army member, you know, working very closely with the people I was associated with in Afghanistan. So that was kind of nice to have someone who wasn't wearing a uniform, but in fact they were wearing their own kind of uniform that if someone from the military were to look at them, they would know immediately what their role was. So there was also this subculture that I had entered that I had to learn about very quickly, and it was very a very complex sign system.
Sure. Those images, even though they're very pared down, they're still incredibly tactile. The cloth is very significant, the hair is very significant, the flesh is very significant. Each of those elements starts to get a very tactile presence, even in that stripped down landscape.
Yeah, I think I'm influenced by other photographers and also like maybe I'm lucky that they were in focus, I guess, as well. I really love the filmmaker Gus Van Sant, because he rests the camera behind a lot of his subjects, and you get a chance to enter that kind of tactility. In films like Elephant and other films where he has these protracted, extended takes, which can sometimes go on for minutes, and you're just sitting behind someone walking along or sitting, and you're sitting, you know, as a viewer, behind their head, and there's something kind of incredible about that experience. And it's almost like we're kind of with their thoughts. You're in this, even though, I mean, in terms of, you know, neurology, we're in the cerebellum back there, so it's not, that's, you know, we're not really with the complex thinking, but it's nice as a metaphor, I think. Mm. It's a good space to, I mean, I don't know, it's not like I go and sit behind people really closely on public transport, but having a camera gives you permission to do different things.
Well, I think the interesting thing was, I remember the Mark Donaldson VC portrait that you did, and throughout the process of working on this book, we've been, you know, having these, I call them interviews, but they're just chats with food, basically. But we've been talking about your various ideas of approaching that even before you had you chopped that. And initially, you were thinking about that as being a dysfunctional portrait, weren't you? You know, one of the ideas that you had was to have him sitting on the back of a Bushmaster with the dust being kicked up, so you couldn't actually see his face.
Yeah, I kind of like the idea that maybe it would be a portrait, but it would kind of somehow fail. If I was to try and get the camera to record Mark, but the situation would somehow veil him. But it didn't kind of happen that way in the end. But I came from a history of painting at art school, and one of the series of paintings I did was I would veil these kind of society portraits, sort of these English society portraits. I would kind of like, I guess, decapitate them in a way. There'd be these black sort of fields that would descend over the bodies, and I like the idea that people couldn't see the face, that they would have to read all of the grammar gesture, like the way that these figures were posed and the clothing, and that would kind of build up a story. In terms of how Mark's video went, which is the one, it's upstairs, it's on a screen in the corner if anyone wants to check it out. I did want to ask him in the end. I had this vision of what I wanted to do, and then I realized what I was doing was just being an artist trying to impose my vision on the situation. And one thing that I tried to do in Afghanistan, and also again with Mark's portrait commission after, was actually start to maybe work with people and negotiate situations rather than just impose my vision on the scene. And so I ended up starting to formulate the idea around this dysfunctional portrait. I still wanted that somehow. I still wanted the portrait to not be so clear, but then I wanted him to be happy with it. So I started to ask him what he preferred. Would he prefer to be in his workplace, or would he like a formal portrait? I was hoping he was going to say workplace, because the history of VC winners has been very formal and stiff oil paintings for, you know, the entire time that we've been awarding Victoria Crosses. So it was good that he said that he had these moments in helicopters where he had like a respite from just the tension of his job. And I thought, okay, that's great. I'll try and sit behind him in a helicopter. I couldn't sit in front of him in a helicopter because he hangs right on the side of an open door of the helicopter. So that position, standard portrait position, was impossible anyway. It was a work that was kind of group devised in a way.
It's one of the few images that is in the double. I just want to come back to this point in doubles that you've picked up. There's a psychoanalytic joke that with doubles, so two of you is one too many, so one of you has to die. It's interesting, and as we're talking, of course, we have these extraordinary doubles behind us. Can you pick that up and just talk a little bit more about that?
Yeah, I think doubling and just kind of mirroring in general interests me in my work, because I feel like a single image really can contain the idea for me. So I like what happens with the history of art when people would go back again and again and maybe treat the same subject with a lot of different works. So like you have like Monet's ruined cathedral studies, or you know, you could just pick out so many examples of people taking the same subject matter and treating it in some sort of analytic way, because it becomes kind of a study of everything around the subject in a way. I think that the doubling has that appeal, that you can kind of see something from a different perspective, or you can see it again with marginal change or shift. That interests me as an artist. But then also, I think with these kinds of works, you have the whole juxtaposition. Like, they're entirely different environments, and the people are involved in a kind of balancing act, and then maybe there's the potential of reading a connection, even though there isn't actually a connection between those two performances.
It is often read as a veteran and soldier.
Yeah.
Yeah,
and it's something that wouldn't happen without, you know, if we saw that channel video, Bill Shannon wouldn't have that reading, of course. So it's just playing with those kinds of ways to generate meaning. But with the light boxes, that's kind of a bit more straightforward, because it's they're actually scans of my father's forearms and hands, and so it just made sense in that case. It's not a very complex connection to doubling at all. It's just, well, they're not. It's a pair. It's a diptych. It's not actually a doubling in the sense. But I was also interested in, say, this is getting off the subject again, in the kind of power of those images that my father would have on his arms, because he's a Vietnam War veteran, and they are military tattoos. And as a child, I would be walking around with my father, and then people would come up to him almost spontaneously, and then just start talking to him, and they'd have this connection. And I wouldn't understand what was happening until much later in my life. So those works, I felt like it was important to have two, obviously, because they were both significant tattoos, and that dictated the...
With the tattoos then, are they read by people who would have...
Yeah, and they can spot them from a mile off, other Vietnam veterans. Like, literally, telescopic vision. I don't know how it happens. I mean, I guess it's a whole lot of significations, maybe.
Because of age and whatever. That's the other kind of doubling that happens in your work as well, where you have symbols and other, often subcultural code systems, really, that might be read at one particular level by a set of people, and yet within that subculture, it's read in a much more specific way.
Yeah. It's interesting that it's kind of like a symbol's kind of replicated. But even though there's numerous signs out there, they still kind of they're still detached somehow from a bigger sign system. That really fascinates me. But then I guess with the doubling that's going on with the sign, like the graphics here and the paintings, again the first idea of doubling them is simple, because when I looked at these patches that the guys in Afghanistan and girls were wearing, they were doubled because they would have one version for like when they were patrolling at night or doing whatever at night, and then another because they wanted these tan colours that would be camouflaged in the desert during the day. And so it was kind of amazing to walk into, say, like a military supply store and see the same image again in a different colour register. It was quite beautiful. It was like like a Warhol print that was treated in a different way, the same image. And so I became obsessed with that. I wanted to make a series of paintings about what those images meant to soldiers, but also the colour would kind of explain where they would be wearing it. But some of them aren't so internal, these ones, that they're not so sophisticated as like a subculture. I mean, we can pretty much guess that's a feces magnet painting. But the flags are obviously pretty clear, except for the dark ones at night. You only really read those those kind of detailed images on uniforms when you're up very close. And I guess if you're the enemy, it's too late by that stage.
Shaun, you're calling it a feces magnet, but I think earlier you called it a shit magnet when we were talking.
Yeah, yeah. We're all okay with that, aren't we? We're all okay with that. Okay. Should get a bit real here. Yeah.
You really lose some of the culture if you don't give it its proper name.
That's what everyone who would be wearing it would be calling it a shit magnet, of course. Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. But it's kind of nice because I think that there's something, you know, different about the patches. Like, some of them were really sort of self-deprecating and kind of humbling or self-effacing or something, like that one, like the shit magnet one. It was like, oh, I know it's going to happen. It's, you know, this is another day in the office and it's going to be bad. And then other ones were like, I need to say this to myself to just do the job, you know, and it's a pretty intense saying, something like what happens in those circular canvases. They're pretty serious, like affirmations of power and confidence. And so, you know, within the whole patch culture, you have so many different attitudes, which was great to see. And again, it wasn't my work, it was something that the soldiers would do for themselves. And it was something that I was interested in exploring, that was a part of their visual culture, something that I wasn't just manufacturing entirely myself.
Shaun, I've been fascinated by this video installation at the back of the room, the dummy. Mm. It's the only image, it's the only sequence of images where horror is represented with some kind of visceral clarity. But again, it's a dissembling of horror. So it again doubles itself.
Mm. Yeah, it was a different work for me, this one, because it's an experiment, like all of these works. I'm not really sure what the result is. You know, it's kind of almost like a group shot of several artists, this one. But this was an experiment where I moved away from how I would usually shoot a scene on a fixed frame, like a tripod, and just let the action do its thing. It wasn't possible to represent what was taking place here that way. And what I thought was interesting was that the mannequins that the medics were training on were so real. They were kind of frightening, really, because they were sort of... I just realised, am I really... Can anyone hear me?
Yes.
Yeah.
Cool. So you're just all being really polite. Like, what is he saying?
You are injections.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Anyway, I just... I just thought that, again, I mean, I always think in terms of art historical references, and it's kind of a curse. I shouldn't think so much about what's happened before, but I was thinking, wow, if Hans Bellmer ever saw these things, he'd be so impressed. Mm-hmm. But they're computer controlled, and they bleed at a certain rate, and you see the eyelids move, and the breathing is so complex that if, say, the mannequin slash victim has had a lung collapse, that side of the chest won't move. The dismemberment, all of the blood is kind of calculated so that it will leak out of the body at a certain rate. It was, I guess, in art school I always remember these two terms, that very similarly tuned was something that was very lifelike, but you still knew it was a simulation, but exactitude was getting very close to unbelievable simulation.
Do they scream?
They don't scream, but because I think what happens is they're sort of unconscious at this stage. Yeah. And if they were to scream, I would be out of there. That would be too real for me, because they do everything but scream. And I think that idea that you have this kind of bad faith that takes over, that it's a certain point. When you're kind of working with a team to try and save one of these mannequins, the game or the simulation becomes very real, and that's interesting. I think it's very hard to represent in a video, actually, and I think all of these ideas are very hard to represent. And that was probably the job I gave myself, was to try and not just kind of represent what I was seeing, but trying to look at the problems of getting it across in every instance, in all of the work here. But I do recommend these mannequins as a battle sort of medical training device. They're very powerful and haunting.
You were telling me earlier that they die.
They do die. Yeah, if you're not good enough at dressage or you know, putting those tourniquets on, then once they stop breathing and the eyes stop moving and the blood continues to flow, the game is over.
So you can save.
Yeah, it's a successful process that can take place where the result is that you stop the situation so that they're in critical state and they are stabilized. Just like in a real situation, they try and make it as close to the actual situation that these people. It's quite eerie to think that the people who are involved in these simulations would be potentially facing the real thing within a few hours' time, a few days' time, and that's quite eerie. But I think that in this case, for me, it was more powerful to represent the simulation.